came today, Jim took out. If it works, we'll have cookouts every week. Primarily because I'm a former Baptist and we just ate all the time. Every time we turn around, we're going to what, some sort of dinner. But that's okay. God is good, amen?
Amen.
So how many have been with us for the last few weeks? What about the rest of you? Wait, man. We've been talking. This is fixed with somebody singing, not reading the Bible. All right. Well, I'll just quickly recap, if I can. About 3 weeks, 4 weeks ago, we started talking about faith. And some people just say I talk too much about faith. Well, I'll just have to point out Hebrews 11:6 says that without faith, it's impossible to please God. So I want to know as much as I can about how to please God as I can. And so he says that we've been called to walk by faith, not by sight.
Yes.
He said, now the just shall live by faith. It's a commandment. And so we need to understand what faith is. And we've been looking at that. And I'm not going to go back over the whole last 3 weeks. We have these on our YouTube channel. How about that? Faith Life has a YouTube channel. Never thought I'd be there. But we have one. And we archive all these messages. We're on camera right now. So you can go back. And I encourage you to, with your notebook, with your Bible, with a pen, and take notes. Get this word into you, because it's not going to do you any good if it just goes out in the airwaves today and you don't know it.
Yeah.
You don't remember it. Yeah. You can't do anything with it. And so we teach you how to take the word of God and apply it to your situation. Yeah. As Lynn said, the teenagers, they've got just as much challenges as the adults do. Mm-hmm. And sometimes much more. They have peer pressure that's greater than what I have. I don't have any peer pressure because I don't care what people think of me.
Hallelujah.
But it's different when you're in school and you got friends. I was there at one time. And I was led astray by my friends because I wanted to fit in. I get that.
Amen.
But we know that the enemy is luring those young people down the wrong road.
Yes.
And so if we can get the word into them at a young age, they're going to move mountains when they're teenagers.
Yes.
I'm talking miracles, signs, and wonders they're going to be doing as teenagers.
Amen.
I've said it before, I say it again. We're big on healing around here, and I'd rather have a 5-year-old that gets it pray for me.
Amen.
Because they don't have any jump of all the years of learning and hearing different stuff. Look, just because it's on Christian radio doesn't mean it's right.
Hello.
Uh-oh. Just because it's on television and they paid for that time and they say they're a Christian, well, they may be a Christian and they probably going to heaven if they are a Christian. They are going to heaven. But they might be off in some area. So I encourage you, don't just take my word for it. Open up the book.
Yeah.
This is what we're going to get into our kids, the book.
Yeah.
They'll take this wherever they go for the rest of their life.
Amen.
I won't be able to go with them. My wife won't let me. Want to, but we have other priorities, right?
Amen.
So anyway, so faith is important to God. And so we find out that faith is... it's just that truly trusting God to where we know that 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 God's going to pull through.
Yeah.
And because of that, I can say with authority, I take it now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now faith is. Faith isn't tomorrow. He's not going to heal you tomorrow. He's going to heal you now. Now faith is. Now is the acceptable time of salvation. Now salvation is. Now sozo is.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
That's it.
Everything needed for your spiritual being, your physical being, and your mental, soulish realm is all inclusive in salvation. So we want to get the word of God. And once somebody makes that decision, now the Bible says in Romans 12 that you need to renew your mind to how God's kingdom operates. You were translated out of the kingdom of darkness and into the kingdom of his dear son. But you've never been there before. Mm-hmm. When I got there, I never had been there before. Mm-hmm. Everything's different.
Yeah.
And you have to renew your mind to what God has said. I'm so thankful we've got this book.
Yeah.
Don't take my word for nothing that I say. Check it out in the book.
Yeah.
Now, I'm conscious and mindful that I'm going to be accountable to Christ Jesus when I come face to face to him. He's going to ask me, son, what did you do with what I gave you? I'm going to have to give an account. I'm going to have to answer. I won't have my previous pastors there with me holding my hand saying, here, here's the answer. Yeah. No, I'm going to have to give an account of my life.
Amen.
And so are you. Mm-hmm. And so it's important that you know how to operate in the things of God.
Yes.
This isn't just church. You're the church.
Yeah. Yeah.
This building is not the church. You are the church.
Yes.
This building, we're blessed with a building to where we can have the air conditioning on this morning and you don't have to be sitting there sweating.
Yeah. Amen.
And in the wintertime when it's below zero out there,
glory,
that you can come inside and have some heat.
Yeah. Thank you.
And so we thank God for blessing us.
Yeah.
And we receive his blessings.
Yeah. Yes.
And all that you see here, that we built in here is paid for.
God.
But we still have a note that we're paying on the building. But I believe it's paid off now.
Yeah.
In the spirit realm, it's paid for.
Yes.
And the money's on its way.
Yes.
Because it's settled in my heart and it's settled in heaven.
Yes.
It's just a matter of working it out.
Yep.
You know, God says that we have to work out our salvation.
Yep.
That doesn't mean you work for your salvation. It means once you're saved, you have to work out through the word of God to apply these things. If you want blessings, you have to apply them to your life and receive them.
Yes.
Now, Hannah's not here today, but she's received money from me twice. She's new to the church, and they're away on vacation. But I had her come up, and I held, the first week, I only had $5 bills in my pocket. And she didn't even know me. She'd never met me before. Mm-hmm. And I said, I want to give you this. And I had her stand like 3 feet away. Well, she stood there and looked at me like a cow at a new gate. And I said, I want you to have this. And finally, she kind of got a little closer and shook. But when she grabbed a hold of it, boy, did she pull it. I didn't have to teach her as a teenager.
Come on.
She's like 15 years old. She knew. Once I get a hold of it, it's mine.
Yeah.
But I wanted to show people that you have to receive. You have to take.
Yeah.
Receive means to take.
Yeah.
So when it comes to healing, I take my healing.
Yeah.
I have to agree with what settled in heaven, settled in the word of God, that by the stripes Jesus bore, I was healed. Not trying to get healed. So it starts in here. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for. Hope is that inner image that sees you well.
Yeah.
Before you're well.
Yeah.
You have to see it in here, in your knower, before you can see it manifest.
Amen.
You have to see yourself out of lack before you can have that happen in the natural.
Mm-hmm.
Before the money starts showing up.
Mm-hmm.
You have to have that inner image, that blueprint that God puts in your spirit man that says, I believe what he said and I take it.
Yeah.
Amen.
And that's how we live as Christians.
That's right.
And we don't put up with the junk that the devil's throwing around.
Mm-hmm.
We don't agree with it. If you find yourself agreeing with it, well, stop it.
Yeah.
And get back into the word of God.
That's right.
And so we shared with you, and I encourage you, don't let this go by. These last three messages have been so important for you to live in victory. Now, if you don't care if you get your head beat up every week, well, that's on you.
Yeah.
But I don't like that. I don't like pain. I don't like sickness. I don't like lack. When I found out I could believe God for finances, I started believing him. And guess what? He shows up in the least likely ways. And so that's what the word says. And so I believe it, and therefore I operate in it. So every day, you know, Lynn mentioned that the teens have things coming against them. Don't you think I do?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I have to walk by faith every single day.
Yes.
Amen.
Because the enemy's good. I've got a target on my back. Now, what do I got? Believe all things are possible to him that believes.
Yeah.
But the enemy sees me as a target, and he wants to shoot his arrows, but I don't let them hit me.
That's right. Amen.
I continue to abide under the shadow of the Almighty.
Yes.
And so 1,000 may fall at my side and 10,000 at my right hand, but it's not coming near me.
Amen.
Amen.
Some people say that's too cocky, that's too arrogant. No, that's faith.
That's faith.
You've got to let the devil know or he's going to take you for a ride you don't want to go
on.
That's right.
And so we've seen it for years, for decades. You've got to run him out of your life.
Amen. Amen.
And so, you know, I get a little snippy here, but that's because the devil is trying to take you out.
Mm-hmm.
He comes to steal, kill, and destroy.
Yes.
I haven't even warmed up yet, so just hold on. John 10 and 10, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Jesus didn't leave us there. He said, but I have come. Has he come?
Yes.
Absolutely, he's come. That you might have abundant life. I want you all to have abundant life.
Amen.
We're praying on the way in this morning that you guys would get this today. That your ears would be hearing ears today.
Amen.
That your hearts would want to receive it.
Yes.
And that you'd walk out of here different.
Yes.
Yeah.
You'd walk out of here with a word, a rhema word that you get this morning.
Yes.
Yeah.
A word, a rhema word that the devil can't steal from you.
Amen.
See, the devil can't shut my mouth anymore.
That's right.
Once I, and it was when I decided I didn't care what people thought.
Yeah.
If you don't like what I'm saying, you can get up and leave. We're not holding you down. I want to be preaching to people that want to hear.
Yes.
And I'll go out to the world and I'll preach to people that want to hear. If they don't, well, they didn't to always to Jesus.
Yeah.
He said, just wipe the dust off your feet. And go to somebody that will listen, that will receive the goodness of God.
Amen.
It's God's goodness that leads men to repentance. I don't want to ever argue with anybody.
Yeah. No.
If you just don't like the message, well, you're not in the right place.
Right.
There are people that choose not to be here because they don't like the message I preach.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm preaching this message.
Yeah.
The same Spirit of God's in me, and we're preaching the gospel message.
Yeah.
Yes.
And so they're just going to have to, I just tell them, go get your Bible and open it up.
Yeah.
You start reading it, and then you come back and talk to me and see if I wasn't telling you the truth. And so that's where we've been. We've been talking about how important faith is, and that this is how we're going to operate in God's kingdom.
Yeah.
Yes.
Jesus, in Acts chapter 1, after he had been crucified, after he came back and appeared to over 500 people, and he was with the disciples, and he had a seminar for 40 days. It says in Acts chapter 1. Check it out. He taught them the things about the kingdom.
Yeah.
Amen.
That's why I'm so big about the kingdom. And Jesus' messages, he didn't just have a clock and say, well, it's noontime and you can go home now. He preached until he was done preaching.
Amen.
It could be 9 o'clock at night and the sun's gone down. And when he got done preaching, it was because everything out of here came out.
Yeah.
And then he had to go get charged up again. But you know something? If you read the Gospels, people kept following him.
Yeah.
People kept following him. Why did multitudes, thousands and thousands of people follow him? Because he had the goods.
Yeah.
Yes.
He had the goods. He had the healing power. He had the compassion. People would come to him in sin, and we're going to look at a story today, and they were in a bad place, and the law says, well, we got to stone them. And they brought him to Jesus and said, what do you say?
Mm-hmm.
Well, Jesus knew what the law said. Jesus didn't open his mouth. Remember that story?
Yeah.
We're going to look at it. He got down and he wrote on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
See, sometimes you just got to shut your mouth.
Yeah.
That duct tape's coming. I've patented Christian duct tape. You can't say the right thing. You just put that over your mouth.
Yeah.
And when you can speak the word of God, we'll take it off.
Right.
That'll help you. That will keep you alive.
Yes.
That will keep you healthy. So many people they speak the wrong thing.
Yeah.
And we looked at that.
Yeah.
Faith in two places. It's in your heart and it's coming out your mouth.
Yeah. That's right.
Faith in two places. It's voice activated. Your faith is voice activated.
Yeah.
That's another whole message.
Wow.
But we touched on it. What you're saying is what you're getting.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't like what you got, you got to change what you're saying.
Amen.
Come on, don't chop me down just because I'm preaching real good.
Amen.
Amen.
God wants you to be victorious.
Yeah.
His Son paid a dear price for you to be victorious.
Amen.
The chastisement of our peace was upon him.
Yep.
So that we could have peace. That means you can go to sleep at night without crying and fretting and worrying and having anxiety attacks and panic attacks.
That's right.
You can have peace.
Yeah.
And go to sleep, even when the rockets are flying around here and the viruses are coming and all hell's broken loose in the earth.
Yeah.
And listen, it's going to get worse.
Amen.
Yeah.
This is just the beginning of the birth pangs.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So you women that have been in labor before, it didn't just one bang, pang, and oh, I'm going to have the baby, and then the baby came. No. They come what? Stronger and stronger?
Yep.
And closer together?
Yep.
Jesus said that's going to happen. But we don't have to be fearful of it. We don't have to let the world take us out. No, Jesus is going to airlift this out of this place.
Amen.
So this is a good time that we are living in a time that nobody else has lived in before.
That's right.
I've heard people say, I said it myself, I've never seen these crazy things. How can people think the way they're thinking? We've never seen it before. We're in that sliver of time. Nobody's ever seen, you know, they saw Jesus go, those that watched. And Enoch went. I don't know if anybody saw him go, but we're going to go.
Amen.
And what ride that's going to be. My ticket's all purchased.
Yeah.
Jesus purchased that ticket for me. I didn't have to pay for it.
Reservation.
Come on. First class.
That's right.
Heaven's class. Yeah. We're all going heaven's class.
Yeah. Yeah.
Reservations all set.
Yep.
And so, by faith, we receive what Jesus, what God did by grace. For by grace are you saved. Through faith. Not that of yourselves.
No.
He did it. His grace. Our faith, though, had to cooperate, didn't it? Our faith has had to come together and grab a hold of His grace. See, you have to receive grace. Paul talks about multiplied grace on you. Multiplied grace. But you've got to receive it.
Yeah.
You've got to receive it. You know, we're so blessed when we go over to see Barb and Steve. Because the blessing is just a flowing. You just get in that house.
That's
it's
right.
A house of prayer.
Yeah. Yeah.
They don't just pray once a week.
No.
They're praying morning, noon, and night.
Amen.
And in the middle of the night.
Amen.
And then whatever else they can pray. And they're what are they doing? They're bringing God's goodness towards themselves. They're bringing God's goodness towards you if you pray with them. We've never been to their house before where we haven't prayed.
Amen.
I would be upset if we didn't. If they said, well, we're going to bed, see you later.
Yes.
I said, wait a minute. We haven't prayed. And they know how to pray. That's another whole message we're going to talk about. Not today. We're talking about faith.
Yeah.
All right, I want to talk about, does anybody have an ETA of the burgers? Okay, I know it's early, so. And I'm in no hurry, because I got lots. I'm aiming for bear today.
Right.
So, glory to God. That's not where I want to be. Go over to Galatians with me. Galatians chapter 5.
Yeah.
And as excited as I get about teaching faith and as I share how I've lived this way for probably 30 years now, three decades, I didn't always know. I was like a goose in a snowstorm years ago. I just thought that whatever's going on, God's in charge. See, that'll take you right into shipwreck. That'll derail you if you just think God's doing everything. Because He's not. And that's a message you'll hear on Christian TV.
Right.
That God's just in charge of everything. No, He's not. He's never been in charge of earth. He gave that to Adam.
Right.
See, that'll get me thrown out of probably most churches in America. But you read the Bible. Go to Genesis and see.
Yep.
Matter of fact, my lights.
Yeah,
did I have my lights again? Is this a trick?
Yes.
I got a flashlight in my office. I'll get it if I have to.
God said, let there be light.
Yes, He did. Yes, He did. Yes, he did.
That
so,
that's the one He needs. So.
Which way? Is there a dimmer on that? Can you check the dimmer? There is a dimmer switch on. Pulpit light. All right, it'll come. God said, verse 26, Genesis 1, God said, let us make man in our image according to our likeness. Let them have dominion.
Amen.
Let them have dominion.
Amen.
Let them have dominion. If He let them have dominion, who doesn't have dominion?
He doesn't.
He doesn't.
Yeah.
He didn't reserve dominion for Him on planet Earth. Now, he is supreme, sovereign of all that. We don't even know what He's created. It's so vast. But little old teeny planet Earth, He made for His kids, and He put Adam in charge. And then Adam, he messed up. We know that. But we might have messed up, too, if we were Adam.
Yeah.
So we're not condemning him.
That's right.
But 4,000 years later, God got Jesus into the earth as a man.
Yes.
Dominion was given to man.
Yes.
And it had to get back into the hands of man legally.
Amen.
God couldn't just say, time out. Adam messed up, take two. This isn't Hollywood. He honestly gave Adam dominion on the planet.
Yeah.
And then it says, go with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I want to show you something here. Because you say, well, I never heard that before.
Yeah.
That Adam was literally... where are we here? Second Corinthians 4, verse 3. But even if our gospel is veiled, it's veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded, whom do not believe. The God of this age has blinded. God's not blinding people. Satan was by virtue of, he stole it, but he got it from Adam. And so he's the God of this world.
Amen.
Jesus said the God of this world has already been judged. He says, I have no part in him. So Satan is still loose in the earth. Satan still has his kingdom system set up. But Jesus came and set up his kingdom.
Amen.
And that's the difference. His kingdom's been put where? Luke 17 says it's inside of you. So now we carry the kingdom, and now we've got that authority back in us, the church body. And I would have to say this, it's to those that have accepted Jesus, that have accepted this part of the word. Because not everybody believes all the word.
That's true.
Yeah.
You know, people say, well, what kind of church are you? Like, sometimes I don't even know how I want to answer them.
Yeah.
But I tell them, I said, well, I believe the whole Bible. And they look at me like, well, doesn't everybody? No, everybody doesn't.
No.
Yeah.
And then when I tell them, I say, well, I believe in miracles, signs, and wonders. I believe in healing. Oh, well, didn't that go out back with those dudes that hung out with Jesus?
No.
It didn't.
No.
It was delegated to you and me all the way down. Every generation since then has had that authority. And so we see that God has put that dominion in man. And that's why it's so important that you know the word. So that you know what word you can speak in this earthly realm and have it come to pass. Because it says over in 1 John chapter 5, I think it's verse 12 or verse 14 right in there, that we have to be, well, let's just turn there. I want you to see it. See, I just start quoting things and I don't want to do that. I want you to see it for yourself. In 1 John chapter 5, verse 14. Now this is the confidence that we have in him. If we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we have asked of him. Notice in verse 14 it says, if we ask anything according to his will. So you have to be, your will has to be in alignment with God's will if you're going to ask the Father something. And when you do, you get it. I said, when you do, you'll get it.
Amen.
But if you're asking just any old thing that God's not backing, then you're asking amiss. We have to ask according to his will. So that's why the word's so important. That's his will. That's his last will and testament, the New Testament. If we don't know his will, how are we ever going to align our faith and our will with his will?
Yeah.
That's why we have to know it.
Yeah.
Beloved, I pray that you prosper in all things. Say all things.
All things.
And be in good health. Say good health.
Good health.
Not marginal, not, you know, just barely breathing.
Yeah.
In good health. But what's the last part?
Just
as your soul prospers. Your soulish realm is your mind, your will, and your emotions.
Yep.
Too many people are just living out of their emotions.
Yeah.
Now, our emotions are there for a purpose, but not to be dictating how we live. No, we walk by faith, not by sight.
Amen.
So we have to prosper our soul. Our mind has to get renewed.
That's right.
Romans 12.
Mm-hmm.
We've got to renew our mind. so that we don't stay conformed to the world. This is really simple. Can I get an amen here?
Amen. Amen.
This is not really deep theology. I don't like deep theology. I've listened to, it seemed like a good message, but it's just like, if I come away scratching my head,
yeah.
It's just like, and I've been in the Word for quite a while. If I don't get it, it's like, how's anybody that doesn't know what anything is going to get?
Exactly.
I'd rather teach that this little boy down here can understand what I'm saying.
Amen.
Yes.
Then I know that I've taught according to, because Jesus loved the little children, didn't he?
Yes.
He loved when they came to him. And they came to him. And he didn't give no theological messages.
That's right.
Well, I went to such and such seminary. He didn't get all religious. No, who did that? The Pharisees and the Sadducees and all those other seeds.
Yeah.
Chicken of the sea.
No.
All right. So let's go back to Galatians.
Chicken of the soup.
It means anything. It's important that you get it. I'm not in a hurry to, I thought 3 weeks ago was just a one-time message and it ended up being 3 weeks worth. So I'm not in a hurry. I want you to get it.
Amen.
If you agree with me, then you've got ears to hear.
Yeah.
And then you're the one going to receive.
That's right.
You can sit here and not give a rip, and you won't get a thing.
That's
and
right.
You'll think, oh, church is boring. Yep, church is boring. You know, there was days in my life when I thought church was boring. And no offense to the churches I was in. But when I found out there was more, when I found out that I didn't have to get whooped and have my head beat in and live, begging God for something.
Yep.
You don't have to beg him for anything. We're his kids.
That's right.
Do you force your kids to beg from you?
No. No.
I'm going to slap you if you say yes. If not, I'll get Steve to come over and sit on you. Then I'll slap you.
Oh, no.
I love you. Love. In love. We're talking about love today. In love. I hope we don't get disconnected now, because that's not good. Hang on there, hang in. All right, Galatians 5. I'm sorry, Galatians 4. Galatians, no, 5, 6. 5, 6.
Right.
4, 5, 6.
Yes.
Numbers. No, we're not going to Numbers. We're in Galatians.
That's right.
Verse 6. For in Christ, I'm going to read it in the Amplified. Neither circumcision nor uncircumcision counts for anything, but only faith activated. Oh, isn't that interesting? Faith has to be activated. Only faith activated and energized. Where does the energy come from? Well, we could look in Ephesians where it says that the power of God is inside of us. So we have to activate that power. And today's message is so vitally important, and until you get this message today, you won't operate in the power. Because you'll just be blowing people up. You'd be having your neighbors taken out. You'd be having people, somebody that cuts you off, you'd be having them taken out,
You can't do that.
That's important, how you drive. And
it is.
What you say when you drive. Hand signals you use when you drive. You get what I'm saying?
I do.
It shows what's in there. It just, some of that just needs to get rooted out. I used to yell at people on the road years and years ago. But anyway, so only faith activated and energized and expressed. See, faith has to be expressed. Remember in that story when those four crazy guys, they came to the meeting where Jesus was, and they're sick and tired of toting this guy around on a car. They're playing stickball, and they got to carry old Joe. And they go fishing, and they got to carry Joe. Now, they had to walk. They didn't have cars like we have today. And they heard Jesus was a healer, and Jesus was in the house. And they get to the house, but it's full. Can't get in. You can't even see through the windows. The doors are all blocked. But they didn't give up. They looked up. And they climbed up on the roof with crazy Joe and his four crazy friends. And they started ripping the roof off the house. We don't hear about that in church today, do we?
No.
See, people aren't expressing their faith the way they did back then, because these guys were expressing their faith, weren't they?
Yeah.
I'm going to show you that. Because they lowered him down on the cart right in front of Jesus, and the Bible says Jesus saw their faith.
Yeah.
He saw their expression. He saw what was inside of them manifest so that they did something. And that's what faith is. It's acting on what you believe. So easy. Just act on what you believe. So if you believe that your needs are met, you can't be talking broke.
Yeah. Amen.
Right?
If you're believing that God supplies all your needs, you can't be saying, well, how in the world is this ever going to work out? We're just going to go under. We're going to lose our house. You can't talk that now.
That's right.
Not like that.
That's wavering. Way wavering. You're tipping the boat over.
That's right.
Capsizing the boat.
Yeah, that's good.
James says, don't waver. That means once you stand in faith, you don't move.
Right.
For no one.
Right.
God won't move you. Only the devil and your close circle of friends will try to move you.
Mm-hmm.
What you don't really believe,
yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You better know what you really believe.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Otherwise, you'll say, well, see, you've already lost it right there.
Yeah.
It got to come out of your mouth. You better believe I believe this. Because this is what I believe.
Amen.
And I'm going to stand here. Yeah, but don't you know the doctor's report said... I don't care what the doctor's report said. I thank the doctors. They do what they can. You know, they take pain away sometimes when pain hurts. But they're not final say, is my point.
Amen.
Jesus, Messiah,
amen.
Who's inside of me by his spirit, has final say.
Amen.
So you get to say,
thank you.
You get to be final say. See, so if you get to say final, you get to be the final say that it isn't God. That little word, IF, if. If you do this, you get this result. If you do that, you get a different result. We saw that over in Deuteronomy. God said, I set before you death and life, the blessing and the curse.
Yeah.
And then he said, you choose. Who gets to choose?
I
do. You do. God didn't say, therefore, I'm right, I'm choosing for you. God didn't do that.
No.
Did he?
No.
He said, who choose?
We do.
You choose.
Yep.
I choose. So if I'm going to live broke all my life, it's because I chose to.
Amen.
It's because I rejected this.
Amen.
Yeah.
If I stay sick all my life, it's my fault, not God's.
Yeah.
I can't blame him because he told me what to do. Come on, it's getting quiet.
Amen.
It's getting quiet.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Let's go to Luke 15. Luke chapter 15. Is this okay?
Yep.
Yeah.
All right. It's going to have to be. Because I don't have another message. I got the Word of God, and that's all I'm bringing. And I'm sticking to it. That's my story. All right, Luke 15, 11. Luke 15, verse 11. Then he said, this is Jesus speaking, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So the father divided to them his livelihood. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal living. Loose, no restraint, just lived any old way he wanted to. But verse 14 says, but when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed the swine. So he got a job feeding pigs. Remember where he came from? From a home that had a lot. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate. So he was so destitute that he's eating what the pigs were eating. Come on, get this picture. Because nobody gave him anything. But when he came to himself, you need to highlight that and underline that. But when he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger?" See, his father had hired servants. Mm-hmm. How many of you have hired servants? This man was wealthy. And he got this young man, the younger brother, got his inheritance. So he didn't just get $150 and then left. I imagine he had to take several wagons full. I bet people went with him and helped him carry all of the inheritance. But he says, "What am I doing here?" He came to himself. He said, "How many of my father's hired servants have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger? I'll arise and go to my father, and will say to him, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. And I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.'" So this is the young boy's plan. "And he arose and he came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion. And he ran and he fell on his neck and he kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight.'" "And I'm not worthy any longer to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Bring out the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet. And bring the fatted calf here and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost, now he's found.' And they began to be merry." Now that's not the end of the story. "Now the older son was in the field. And as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. 'What are they partying for?' And the servant said to him, 'Your brother is come, and because he's received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf.' But he was angry." The older brother was angry and would not go in. "And therefore his father came out and pleaded with him. And so the older brother answered to the father and said, 'Lo, these many years I've been serving you. I've never transgressed your commandment at any time. And yet you never gave me the young goat that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this son of yours came, who has devoured your livelihood with harlots, you killed the fatted calf for him.' And the father said to him, 'Son, you're always with me, and all that I have is yours. It was right that we should make merry and be glad. For your brother was dead and is alive again. And he was lost, and he is found.'" You know, the last parts of this shows that this man was a very compassionate man, the father. He was very merciful, very loving. And so it doesn't appear that it was because he was harsh and he was a hard taskmaster that the younger son wanted to leave. It's not that at all. That young man, just out of his own sin and lust, wanted to go. It does not appear from this story in any way that this man was hard on him and caused him to want to leave. And you see, we can raise our children in a godly home, but we can't make them believe. We can't make them turn out the way we want them to. We can train them up, and God does have a promise in His Bible, in His Word, that He says, if you train up a child in the way he should go when he's old, he won't depart.
That's right.
Doesn't say he won't get off. It was just lust and sin on the part of the youngest son. We can't guarantee that our children won't rebel and go away for a season. For a season, I said.
Amen.
Because if you train up your children, that's why we're so big on training our children.
That's right.
Because you can stand on that scripture 20 years later, when your adult child is still acting like a child.
Amen.
And getting into things they have no business to get into because they were taught right. But you can't force them and you can't make them. These two sons were brought up in the same environment, weren't they?
Mm-hmm.
One of them got antsy and wanted to leave. The other one, well, we're going to talk about the other one in a minute. So the younger one went to a far country. He probably wanted to get away so that he could just, you know, not have an impact on his family, on his father. And he could just go and do what he wanted. He could lustfully sin and have a good time. We see it all the time. Without any influence. Without, you know, his father sending his servants to bring him back as a slave or whatever. However, we can't get away from God or ourselves. And we see that this young boy, this young man, says he came to himself. His conscience was speaking to him. And I believe it's more than just his conscience was speaking to him. I believe because we see the picture of a merciful father here, I believe that father was praying for him every single day. I believe in the morning he would go out on the porch and he would look to see. And before he laid his head down at night, I believe he went out on the porch and he looked in the distance to see if his son would come home. His heart, the father's heart never changed. We're always going to have our consciences condemning our actions when they get away from the things of God. And regardless of how far we go. And this young boy that went away, he realized that he didn't know everything. But he knew enough. Here's the point. He knew enough to go back. I say this to people. Don't ever run from God. You run to God. You get yourself in a mess. You get yourself into an addiction. You get yourself into trouble with the law or whatever. Don't run away from God. Run to God.
Amen.
God is your answer.
Amen.
God is always there with his arms open, just like Jesus on the cross. He's always there with his arms welcoming you home. So this young son hit rock bottom, didn't he?
Yep.
But fortunately, he did come to his senses. His spiritual eyes were open. And as they said, I believe that his father was continuously praying for him, morning, noon, and night. Verse 21, it says, and the son said to the father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and am no longer worthy to be called your son. This was a true repentant heart of this young man. He didn't blame anybody else. How often do we see people blame God or try to put their finger on somebody else for their actions? But this boy didn't. He truly got into a mess. We all know that. But he truly repented in his heart. He wasn't blaming God. He was willing. There's some key points here that you can see how you know that. This young boy, he didn't come back and demand anything.
Yeah.
He came back and said, I'll be willing to be one of your servants. That, he humbled himself. He didn't demand anything. Oh, the heart of people in culture today, how they're just demanding.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
how they just have a heart that's not like this young boy. They demand because they feel entitled. But just as this father didn't want a servant, he didn't want him to come back and hire him as a servant, so too does our Heavenly Father. He doesn't want us to be servants. He wants us to be sons.
That's right.
Now, we do serve him, but there's a difference between serving somebody you love and being a servant. The heart of the Father is that we be sons, that we enter into sonship. That means we participate and have everything he has.
Amen.
Amen.
See, we've limited God, I believe, in our own lives. Each one of us, to different degrees, have limited him and not allowed him to be God in our life, to bless us truly the way he wants to bless us.
Yeah. Amen.
Joey, do we have that song? Can you cue that up now? Yes, we do.
Praise the Lord.
Green hand.
We're the sons of God.
Amen.
God wants sons.
Yeah.
In Romans chapter 8, verse 12. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh to live according to the flesh, for if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. In Jeremiah chapter 10, verse 23, he says, O Lord, I know the way of man is not in himself. It is not in man who walks to direct his own steps. No, the Bible says, in Psalm 37:23, that the steps of a man are ordered of the Lord. You see, this young man got off and went to do his own thing. See, you always get into a train wreck when you try to do your own thing.
Amen.
That's why it's so important to know how to hear the voice of the Lord. And we shared with you for all of January and part of February, I believe, on how to find your destiny, how to find the will of God for your life. Because only the Spirit of God can reveal it to you. But we see here in this story that this young man, he got away, but he came to himself. What was put inside of him came back up.
Yeah.
Made a difference, didn't it?
Mm-hmm.
From staying in pig slough,
yep,
to coming back and being received back as a son. Again, many people blame God for their own circumstances. But you can't show that by the Word of God. We bring things upon ourselves because of decisions we make, because of things we say. And I know it's more convenient. That's convenient Christianity, when you can just blame everything over onto God.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know why so-and-so died of sickness. I guess God just, you know, it was his will. No, it's not his will. That shows me you don't know his will.
Amen.
That shows me that somebody didn't do something right. Okay? And so, you've heard that God works in mysterious ways. No, he doesn't. I know my God. I know how he will react. I know how he acts. He says it in his word. Yes, the Bible says that things were kept in a mystery, but they were kept for us to find out.
Right.
We're not still staying in, I wonder what God has. No, he wants us to know the deep and intimate things of him, the Bible tells us. Truth is, what you allow, God will allow.
Yeah.
What you allow, God will allow. Well, why did God let this happen? Why did you let this happen? See, you're putting it over onto God. Why did he just allow it to happen? I hear it all the time. Well, things just wouldn't work out for me. And you've been a believer for 30 years. Why are things not working out for you? What you're saying is, God didn't pull through and I'm giving up. See, you can't give up. Faith never gives up. Remember I said, right here. Faith stands right here. I don't move from here until I get the victory.
Amen.
I don't move. But we give him 1 year, 3 years, 5 years, and say, well, it's just, I guess it wasn't his will. Well, that tells me you didn't know what his will was 5 years ago. Come on, I'm not preaching harsh here. I'm trying to show you that we can know what the Father has for us. And our circumstances, again, we bring so much on ourselves. You want a new theology? It's called mirror theology. Go stand in front of the mirror. And you'll see the problem to most of your problems.
Right.
I heard one preacher say this: if you could kick in the backside the one responsible for most of your problems, you wouldn't be able to sit down for 3 weeks. It's true.
Amen.
God will allow what you allow. He said, death and life I've set before you.
Yes.
The blessing and the curse. But you choose. What have you chosen? What have I chosen?
Yeah.
I've made wrong choices before, and I had to live with the consequences.
Yeah, that's right.
But I can't blame my father for that.
No.
No more than this young man could blame his father for him getting into the pig slough.
Yeah. That's right.
Can't blame your father. Mm-hmm. And guess what? The father doesn't blame you.
Yeah.
He restores you back into sonship. Turn with me to 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy 3. 16. Let me know when you're there. How's the cookout doing, Steve?
Very good.
Okay. Things are going good in here, too. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. All Scripture, say all Scripture.
All Scripture.
Is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. That the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. It's the word of God. God uses his word to instruct us. He uses his word to teach us. If you're being taught lessons by God, he's using his word to teach you. He's not putting cancer on anybody to teach them anything. That's of the devil.
Amen.
It is.
And if you're a Christian, if you've accepted Jesus as your Savior, you need to know his will regarding healing and health. He says right here, that's his word.
That's right.
He desires you to be in good health.
Yes.
Talk to him about it.
Yes.
Well, that's not the way I learned when I was growing up. Big deal. That's not the way I learned when I grew up either. It wasn't until I learned to open up the word for myself and allow the Spirit of God to show me.
Amen.
And then I began to see the truth. You know, you can't go with just general populist consensus, you know, the majority. Read chapters, Numbers 13 and 14, and you'll get to see, you know, when those spies were sent out, 12 of them.
Yep.
12 of them set out, saw the same situation. They all came back. 10 of them had a report different from 2 of them. So the 10 is greater than the 2. Well, we better side with the 10. And that's what they did. That's what they did. And that's why they wandered for 40 years.
That's right.
And God said that the report they came back with, those 10, was evil. It was wicked. They said, Joshua and Caleb, they have a different spirit about them.
Yep.
Spirit of faith.
Yes.
Said, we're well able to go in. God said, I'm giving it to you. My goodness, don't walk the other way when God says, I'm giving you something. If he says, I'm giving it to you, you're going to get it.
Yeah.
But if you go the other way, and they all sided with those 10. And then Moses, he had a heck of a time. Because everybody's all ticked off. So we see that God teaches us by his word right here in 2 Timothy 3, 16, 17. And when we submit to it, we can be perfect, thoroughly furnished, without having to experience tragedy first. See, we can learn from other people's mistakes. We don't have to make the same mistakes.
Exactly.
I would rather learn from somebody else's mistakes. Because they say, you know, one of the greatest teachers is making mistakes. I'd rather learn from somebody else having made the mistake.
Yes.
Instead of me losing $150,000, I'd rather learn from that guy losing $150,000 and say, I'm not going to quit that one.
Yeah.
Right? I don't have to be stupid. Well, I just want to learn. How many of I had my kids at one point in their life? Say, well, just let me make my own mistakes.
Okay.
Came out of their mouth, didn't it?
Yeah.
Now, there were times when I had to not let them make their own mistakes. Well, he's so cute. I just want him for a boyfriend. No. Dad says no. Don't care what you say. This is not an election. This is not, you know, you can't get your brothers and sisters to side with you. Doesn't matter. No.
That's right.
And I'll tell you what, 40 years later, 35 years later, I'm so grateful.
Yes.
I didn't let my daughter go with that one. Because I've seen as an adult where that one ended up.
Amen.
Had a real rocky time. Real rocky time. I don't like rocky times. She needed a struggle. So we see this story as a great example of God's willingness to forgive and to restore. But I want to take it a little bit further. Because he shared this story. Go back to Luke 15 with me. And you don't usually hear a lot of people talk about this part of the story. But I think it's important. It's got to be important if God's going to put it in there. Would you agree with me on that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Put my pages back here. This, we started in verse 11, didn't we?
Yeah.
But this parable was in a response to, let's go to verse 1. Chapter 50. Then all the tax collectors and the sinners drew near to him to hear him, Jesus. And the Pharisees and the scribes complained. Uh-oh. We see a lot of that today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Religious people complaining.
Oh, yeah.
This man receives sinners and eats with them. So then he speaks to them a parable saying, what man of you having 100 sheep, if he loses one of them, doesn't he leave the 99 in search into the wilderness and go after that one, which is lost, until he finds it? And when he's found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors and says, rejoice with me, for I found my sheep, which was lost. I say to you that likewise, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 just persons who need no repentance.
Amen.
I think it's in, well, it's not in this translation either. In one translation, it says that the angels in heaven, they take notice when one comes back.
Yes.
And I believe they celebrate and have a party just like this man did. I believe he's dancing in the streets of gold, and they're break dancing down those streets of gold, pure gold. You can translucent gold, and they're partying when one person comes back to him. When one person comes out of the kingdom of darkness and comes to him, they are partying. I think we should learn from our Jewish roots that they partied a lot, didn't they? That shows the condition of their hearts. They were wicked happy. You know? We should let that joy come out.
Yeah, praise the Lord.
And so we see here that Jesus spoke this parable about the prodigal son because the Pharisees were complaining. So in this story, the older brother is representative of the Pharisees. He wasn't outwardly living in rebellion, but he was self-centered. He was jealous. He wasn't walking in love. He was self-righteous. I want you to look at verse 12 with me. Jesus said, a certain man had two sons, verse 11. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. Notice the next part of it. So the father divided to them his livelihood. This older brother got his inheritance too. He got it early. Wealthy. He's a wealthy man. But yet you can still see the heart of the older brother complaining. I've served you all my days. I've never transgressed. He's self-righteous. So the Pharisees did. See, on the outside, yeah, okay, he showed up for work every day. But on the inside, something was going on with that older brother. And we can see that. I've never transgressed. Yeah, right. You've never transgressed. How many here have never transgressed? You know? He's a liar, too.
That's right.
The older brother got his inheritance. And so he became wealthy right at that point, and it was in his name. He probably had to set up places to store his stuff now. Because it says the father gave to both of them. Not just the whining younger one that said, Dad, give it to me. Give it to me now. Notice the older brother received it too. He divided it to him. The older brother cited his own goodness, just as the Pharisees trusted in their own righteousness. If the older brother had been loving and considering his brother, he would have rejoiced when he came back. Let's look at what happened. Was he rejoicing?
No.
No, the father, in verse 22, the father says, bring out the best robe, put it on the one that came back, put a ring in his hand, sandals in his feet, bring the fatted calf here and kill it, let us make merry, let's have a party. For my son was dead and now he's alive again. He was lost and now he's found.
Yes.
And they began to be merry. But the older son was in the field, and when he heard and he asked, inquired about what it was, verse 28 says he was very angry. That doesn't show the love of the brother towards his brother. He wouldn't go in. He was being prideful. Therefore, his father came out and pleaded with him. Come in, celebrate. Your brother's back.
Yep.
See, I don't believe the brother was out on the porch every night looking for his brother. The father was. But the older brother was thinking, well, he got what he deserved. Because look what he already said. This is what was already in the mind of the older brother. He was angry. He wouldn't go in. He answered to his father, Lo, these many years I've been serving you. I never transgressed your commandment at any time. And yet you never gave me a young goat that I might make merry with my friends. Complaining. I can just hear the attitude in this boy's mouth. Speaking to his father. We can see that attitude today. We can see it in our culture today. People just loose living, disregarding other people's property, disregarding authority. We can see it, just like we see it right here. But as soon, verse 30, here's the older brother saying to his father, but as soon as this son of yours came, he had disowned him as a brother. As soon as this son of yours, who's devoured your livelihood with harlots, doesn't say anything, there's no information here to say that he did with harlots, but the brother must have been thinking that.
Mm-hmm.
Brother didn't have a good image of his younger brother when he left.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to look at 1 Corinthians 13 in just a minute, and we're going to see how God has shown us how we're supposed to love one another. And the father said to the older boy, Son, you're always with me. All that I have is yours. It was right that we should make merry and be glad. For your father was dead, and he's alive again. He was lost, but now he's found. This older brother didn't even identify his brother. He disowned him. It shows the bad attitude. See, this older brother, it reflects the attitude of the Pharisees. Pharisees were always trying to come against Jesus. And this brother was coming, this older brother was coming against his father. His father is happy that his son was found and come back. And he's delighted and rejoicing with all the others. But this one didn't care. This showed what was in his heart. And remember, both those brothers were brought up in the same house. And we don't see anything in this story that would tell us that this father was a wicked man, a hard man. They both were brought up in the same way. And so one goes away, but truly repents. And as I said earlier, one of the ways you can see he truly repented is he didn't stop blaming God. He didn't stop blaming anybody else. He blamed himself. He says, I've done this. I'm taking ownership of my own responsibility, of my decisions to make a stupid one. But now I'm back. And I'll come back as a servant. But God doesn't want us as servants.
Amen.
This father didn't want him to come back and start serving him, clean the floors, clean the barn. He wanted him back as a son. Because he is his father. He was his son. The self-righteous religious people say that sinners aren't worthy of a relationship with God. Have you ever felt that attitude? Have you ever heard that attitude? Well, look at them. They're sinning. They don't deserve it. You know what? They're right. They don't. But neither do we.
Right.
None of us. It's by the grace of God. It's by the mercy of God. That shows you how much God loves us.
Yep.
Romans 3:23 says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. In John chapter 8, Steve, what are they telling us?
I think 10 minutes.
Okay. Give me 20. Did I say that? It just came out. Out of the abundance of the heart.
I get it.
You gotta worry. We're only so filled up on God's word by the time you're done, we're not gonna be hungry for it.
Hallelujah!
Well said, my brother. Well said. Go with me to God, John chapter 8. John chapter 8. But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives, verse 1. Now early in the morning, he came again into the temple, and all the people came to him, and he sat down and he taught them.
Yeah.
And then the scribes and the Pharisees brought to him a woman caught in adultery. And when they had her in the midst, they said to him, Teacher, this woman was caught in adultery in the very act. Now Moses, I can just hear their sanctimonious voice. Now Moses in the law commanded, as that such should be stoned. But what do you say? Can't you just hear it in their voices? They said this, testing him, that they might have something of which to accuse him. That's the same thing that older brother did, accusing the father of not being fair. Accusing the father.
Yeah.
I've done everything right, Dad. I didn't run off. So Moses commanded us that such should be stoned. What do you say? They said this, testing him that they might have something to which accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and wrote on the ground with his finger as though he did not hear. You know, there's many times in God's word, in the Gospels, when Jesus refused to listen to what people were saying.
Yeah.
Remember that story when Jairus said to Jesus that my little daughter lies at the point of death. And Jesus said, I'll come to your house and he followed him to his house. And then things got, you know, the woman with the issue of blood took up some time, and Jairus is like, we got to get there. This is serious. My daughter's dying. Well, before Jesus could get to his house, they came from the house and they said, don't trouble him anymore. She's dead. And Jesus just ignored what they said. He ignored that report about the little girl dying.
Yeah.
In the Amplified, I love it. It says that he heard them, but he ignored what they said.
Mm-hmm.
And that message for us is that we need to, when we hear things that don't line up with the Word of God, we need to ignore them.
Amen.
Don't think about them. Don't give place to them. We've got to immediately cast them down. If those thoughts exalt themselves higher than the Word of God, you've got to cast them down.
Yeah.
You have no business thinking about it. This came up in when I was studying on this and letting the Lord speak to me. It came up into me about opinions. Opinions, opinions. Everybody has an opinion.
Oh, yeah.
You know what? If you're born again, you don't have a right to your opinion.
No.
Because you've been bought with a price.
Amen.
And you have the mind of Christ. See, your only opinion should line up with the mind of Christ.
That's right.
Yes. That's harsh, I know. Well, what do you mean I can't have my own opinion? Not if you're born again.
No.
Not if you love God and you want to serve Him.
That's right.
That's just a side thing.
Line up.
So, he bends down. He writes on the ground as if he didn't hear. But they kept pushing him. They kept asking him. He raised himself up again and said to him, to them, "He who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her first." And then he again stooped down and wrote on the ground. I wonder what he wrote.
I don't know. I'm going to ask him. When I get there.
It could have been a lot of things. He could have been writing, "I hope they get this." Do you know? He could have been writing something like that. "I hope these bozos get this." I don't know. He called people vipers. He called them snakes. Yeah. You're if you follow the devil. He called them the devil.
Right.
So if he said bozo, I mean, no disrespect to bozo. We need another bozo. Okay. Another half hour? It's ready. It's ready. Well, I'm not ready. Just tell him to put it on hold.
Amen.
So he stoops back down and writes on the ground. Then those who heard it, being convicted by their conscience. See, that young boy that ran away, his conscience kept speaking to him. He could get away from his family, but he couldn't get away from God. And he couldn't get away from his own conscience.
Yeah.
And so right here we see they were convicted by their conscience. And they went out one by one, beginning with the oldest even to the last. And Jesus was left alone. And do you know that Jesus had every right to throw a stone?
Yeah.
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 Yes, he was.
Do you ever think of that?
Yeah. Yes, he did.
He had never sinned. Jesus was left alone with the woman standing in the midst. And when Jesus had raised himself up and saw no one but the woman, he said to her, "Woman, where are those accusers of yours? Has no one condemned you?" And she said, "No one, Lord." And Jesus said to her, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." Mm-hmm. See, he pardons her. But he doesn't want her to stay in sin.
Right.
God is merciful.
Yeah.
He will always make a way out for you.
Yeah.
He'll always make a way out for you. I don't care what it is. I don't care how hard the addiction is. I don't care how much sin you've gotten involved in. I don't care if you've been a thief for 30 years in your company. God can stop that in your life.
Yes.
Nobody's too far gone. And I know we think there's people in the world that are too far gone. But God will still give them a chance.
That's right.
And many of them won't take that chance. We know that. Because Jesus said, "Broad is the way that leads to destruction."
Yes.
And many take that way. So we know there will be many people that don't ever repent. But until they die, God will give them that opportunity to change their way, to change their mind, to go the other way.
Yeah. Amen.
Regardless of how bad things were.
Yes. Yeah.
Remember, Paul then wrote, at least half of the New Testament was a murderer.
Yeah.
And he wasn't too far gone. Matter of fact, if you notice some of the great people that God uses, I mean, he uses me, and that's amazing. I met with a pastor last week, and he's telling me all the different schools he went to. I went to this theological seminary, and I went to this one, and it's like, my goodness, he's got like 30 years of going to school. I said, "I didn't go anywhere." I said, "Holy Spirit taught me." I didn't have the chance or the opportunity. God never, if he was speaking, I wasn't hearing. But I was hearing on that day when he said, "I've called you to teach." And I fell down to the ground that night. And I had to come to my senses. And I had to say, "What am I going to do?" And at this little church I'm going to, they're asking me to teach Sunday school. I lied to them the first time. I don't know anything about teaching. I mean, that probably wasn't a lie. I said, I don't want to. I just made up an excuse. I don't remember what it was. But then God speaks to me. And I get to go back to that same little church the next day. The next day after God speaks to me. And they ask me again, well, what am I going to do? What are you going to do? When God says, I want you to do this. Do you think I had it figured out? Are you kidding me? I had nothing figured out. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. I was afraid to talk in front of people. How is this going to work? God, surely you meant that guy next to me. I know. He just didn't hear you.
Yeah.
Go back and talk to him. No. No, I heard him, and now I got to do something. Coming home on that Pennsylvania Turnpike in the midnight hour, 1:30, 2 o'clock in the morning, my car is just filled with the presence of God. I couldn't get away from him. I couldn't get away from him. My kids are sleeping in the back seat, and here's me and God driving down the highway. It's like, what am I going to do? He wants me to teach. They want me to teach. I don't want to teach. Come on, I'm just being real. Yeah. I didn't go to all those Bible schools. I would love to go to Bible schools. But I'm retired. We're in a sliver of time.
Yeah.
And we're real close to being airlifted out of here.
Hallelujah.
And I don't want anybody to miss it.
The Holy
and I guess
Spirit
that's
will teach you all things.
Yeah, that's right. That's
yes.
right. And I had to learn. And matter of fact, the first day I was going to teach, I forgot my Bible and my books at home, and I'm 45 minutes away. And the door shut, and I've got about 10 kids looking at me. The new teacher. This is not starting off good. I don't have my material. I don't have my Bible. How many know when you borrow somebody's Bible, it's not the same? You can't find the books. It makes you look silly. I know Genesis is in here somewhere, but I just can't find it. And that's when I said, Lord, what am I going to do? You know what he said? Rely on me. Trust me. If you trust me and follow me, I'll never let you down, is what he spoke to me. So now he's speaking to me all the time. But I've lived that way since. You know, it's interesting when I talk to other, you know, ministers, you know, well, what is your, you know, what is your 6 months out look like? I don't have a clue. Sometimes it's the middle of Saturday night when God tells me what I'm going to say. It's like, I'm feeling like, oh my goodness, they prepared for 6 months to bring this message. It's just like, I get woken up at 2:30 and we go with it.
Holy Ghost.
It's not my fault. Because God called me to teach, and I knew nothing about teaching.
Amen.
And so I just got to follow him.
That's right.
And that's what he does.
Yeah.
And that's the way it is. And so, I told you we're going to go to Corinthians, and then we're going to have some lunch. After we sing some more, no. I want to read 1 Corinthians 13 from the Message Bible. So if you don't have that, just listen. If I were to speak with eloquence in earth, many languages, and in the heavenly tongues of angels, yet I didn't express myself with love, my words would be reduced to the hollow sound of nothing more than a clanging cymbal. And if I were to have the gift of prophecy with a profound understanding of God's hidden secrets, and if I possessed unending supernatural knowledge, and if I had the greatest gift of faith that could move mountains, but have never learned to love, then I'm nothing. And if I were to be so generous as to give away everything I own to feed the poor, and even to offer my body to be burned as a martyr, without the pure motive of love, I would gain nothing of value. Love is large and incredibly patient. You see, even when that older boy got angry, the father was still patient, wasn't he?
Yeah.
He was still merciful to him. Love is gentle. That father was very gentle. It's consistently kind to all. As I read that this morning at home, I was reminded that earlier this week I did a nugget on Facebook about consistency. And here we see love is gentle and consistently kind to all. It refuses to be jealous when blessing comes to someone else. Love does not brag about one's achievements, nor inflate its own importance. Love does not traffic in shame or disrespect, nor selfishly seek its own honor. Love is not easily irritated or quick to take offense. Love joyfully celebrates honesty and finds no delight in what is wrong. Love is a safe place of shelter, for it never stops believing the best for others. Don't ever stop thinking the best for them. Your prayers are heard in heaven.
Yes, they are.
Just because they've gone down a path that they shouldn't be on, don't ever think that they're too far gone. Don't ever speak that.
No.
Don't ever tell them that.
No.
Yeah.
You're to love them.
It's love.
If they're an adult now, you're still to love them. You're done telling them what to do, but you have put inside of them, if you brought them up in the Lord, what they need to do, and they know that. They know they're in sin. You don't have to remind them. We don't have to remind those that we know are going that direction. We need to love them every chance we can.
Amen.
When we see them. We need to pray for opportunities for them to come around us to experience that love, that forgiveness. When that young boy came home, he didn't know what he was going to find. He didn't know, and he was willing to trade places, lose his sonship, and be a servant. That's how bad it got for him. So no matter how bad it is for you today, no matter how bad it is for somebody you know, no matter how sick somebody is right now, that's not too much for God. And we see this chapter 13. Love is a safe place of shelter. It never stops believing the best for others. Love never takes failure as defeat. And never gives up. Love never gives up. So this is the end of the 3 weeks on faith. And we started in Galatians 5 that faith works by love. Doesn't matter how good at faith we get, if we can't have our love walk in check, that's where it's going to start. And if you want the miraculous to start happening in your life, we've got to do 1 Corinthians 13. We've got to do it. We've got to live it. Not just give lip service. Because the Pharisees and the Sadducees, they were always giving lip service to how righteous they were.
Mm-hmm.
And that older brother, he did the same thing. I've never missed it. I've always been here. Blah, 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 blah. We've heard it all.
Yeah.
We're not to judge anybody. And I was going to take you to a few scriptures, but we're not to judge our brothers and sisters. We're supposed to love them.
Mm-hmm.
Judgment's been reserved for God. And we're going to be judged. Bible says we're going to come before the judgment seat of Christ and give an account for what we've done, whether good or whether bad. That day's coming. We can't stop that. We can't get out from that. We can't skip class.
No.
And say, well, I'll just be down at the pearly gates when that day happens.
No.
We're going to be there. I'm looking forward to it. I want a high five from Jesus.
Yes.
I want to go, and I say this, world is getting so stinking crazy, but I want to be going guns a-blazing for God.
Amen.
Both guns a-blazing of faith.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Coming out of my mouth.
Yes.
Coming out of my heart.
Yes.
And I want you there with me. I need you.
Amen.
I need your help.
Yeah.
You know, as we meet with the pastors here, we've claimed this region for Christ.
Amen.
The schools, we're taking them back.
That's Amen. Right.
Not going to teach this crap in there anymore. We're bringing them back.
Yes. Thank you.
We want the teachers saved, filled with the Holy Ghost.
Yes. Hallelujah.
How about if they're having gym class and people are laying hands and people are getting miraculously healed?
Yeah. All right.
That's the way we should be living.
Amen.
Yes. God is so good.
Amen.
Well, as we close, if there's anybody that's either watching or if there's anybody here, if you just bow your heads and close your eyes for a moment. If there's anybody that does not know Jesus in a personal way, you don't have God in your life, and you say, today I want God to come into my life. Well, we want that for you too. And if that's you, I want you to just pray this from your heart. If you mean it, then that's coming from your heart. Just pray this with me. Father in heaven,
I thank you
for loving me
and not bailing out
on me. You love me so much. You sent Jesus
to die for me.
I believe that Jesus died on the cross, that he was raised from the dead, and that today he's seated at the right hand of the Father. And he's calling me right now. So, Father, I thank you.
Thank you.
I've done that in my heart, and I've spoken it with my mouth. Jesus, you're my Lord. So I thank you for saving me and for forgiving me. I ask you, fill me right now with your Spirit. Fill me to overflow. I'll serve you and live for you as a son, as a daughter. I thank you in Jesus' name. Well, if you did that from your heart today, I believe that you're born again. You're now my brother in the Lord or sister in the Lord. And I'm your brother. And you need to tell somebody. If that was you here today, if you'd be so bold, just raise your hand. Was that you? Did anybody for the first time pray that prayer today? Anybody? It's important that you share that with somebody. Why? Because the devil's going to come and try to steal it from you. He can't, but he can get you to be miserable. You need to be proud. See, we need to be proud that we're born again. We can't worry about what the world's going to say about us. I'm not afraid about what they say. Jesus said I'd be persecuted. And so, when the persecution's coming, and it comes, I just thank God that I'm in good company with Jesus. He said, if you're persecuting me, they're going to persecute you.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, we're so glad that you could be here today. I guess before we leave, how are we going to do the offering today? This way.